going to talk about, do you enjoy Christian life? Oh, well, you may say, Johnson uncle, I enjoy Christian life very much and this and that. Then let me ask you a question. I'm sure that many of you love TV programs, many of you like reading newspapers, many of you like reading magazines, your favorite magazine. Think of anything that is favorite to you in your life. Still others, you might have a favorite sport. Now, my question is, when your favorite program comes, you definitely give a lot of attention to that which is your favorite, isn't it? My question is, when it comes to Bible reading, when it comes to prayer, when it comes to family prayer, do you show the same enthusiasm? If not, how can you say that you enjoy the Christian faith? I mean, there are a lot of things that I can point out which you enjoy, but if you don't enjoy Bible reading and prayer and family prayer and going to church and attending church Zoom meeting, if you don't enjoy it with the same zeal, how can you say that you enjoy your Christian faith? We actually fool ourselves into believing that we enjoy Christian faith, whereas actually there are a lot of things that we enjoy. I was listening very carefully to John Abraham uncle. I'm using the title uncle for your sake. He is actually my younger brother in Christ. He mentioned a lot of important things, of which I want to repeat two. One, what are you using your smartphones for? I'm very fond of this question. Do you know why I'm fond of this question? Because whenever I meet any young person who says, Johnson uncle, I want to be more serious in my spiritual life. I want to enjoy devotion. I want to enjoy the presence of the Lord in my mind and in my life. One of the first questions I ask them is, and listen, I enjoy asking this question because a lot of us cheat ourselves into believing that we enjoy our Christian life. So with a lot of enjoyment and a desire to tease them so that they may come to the right understanding, I ask them, okay, do you have a smartphone? Yes, uncle, I have a smartphone. And where do you keep it? Some say I keep it below the pillow. Some say besides my head on the window, this and that. Then I know the question is going to hit the right point. And my first question is, okay, what exactly do you do after you get up in the morning? Suddenly, many of them are stumped. And with a sort of embarrassed smile, they say, uncle, the first thing I do is I pull out the smartphone, I check WhatsApp. WhatsApp has become a disease. And if a young man, if he or she, if the first thing they do when they get up in the morning is to check WhatsApp, obviously they enjoy WhatsApp and the messages in WhatsApp much more than their Christian life. Because if they really love their Christian life, then after getting up, they should be rushing to the bathroom, get a quick wash so as to freshen up. And also because no person should sit in God's presence without following proper protocol. So if a young man or woman is really, if he or she loves the Lord, they would freshen up. And the first thing they would do in the morning is open the scripture to see what God has kept for them on that day. How many of us do it? Honestly, see, on Zoom, I cannot ask you face to face, but you can listen to me face to face and you can honestly answer in your heart. What do I do the first thing in the morning? Be honest to yourself. if pulling out the smartphone, jumping to WhatsApp is the first thing you do, then the answer to this question, do you enjoy Christian life? The answer is automatically no. Because you will do things that you love most, or you will do first the things that you love most. With the realization of what I am saying, let me once again ask the question that Uncle John Abraham presented. Number one, what are you using your smartphones for? There is a second question that I want to ask based upon what Uncle said, because I have been on Zoom now for 14 months, ministering in English, in Hindi, in Malayalam, to a varied group of people. When I say varied, some of them are highly educated. Some of them are almost uneducated, not even literate. In Hindi, I minister to people, villagers who are not even literate. Having studied all this for last 14 months, I came to the realization that Zoom has very thoroughly spoiled us. Because when we sit in front of Zoom, we don't have to open our Bible. We don't need our diaries with us. So even those people who were very regular in carrying the Bible to the church or Bible class and who are very regular in opening the Bible, no longer open it. I realized this about 4 months ago when one of the preachers suggested, Uncle Johnson, are you sure that people are taking notes? So for the next two or three meetings, what we did is, actually I broadcast on Zoom using a computer, not a mobile. And I have a very large 24-inch screen on which I can enlarge each and every person and check exactly what they are doing. So for the next two or three programs, as a research, basically as a research into Christian life and practices, we enlarged and checked and found to our horror that if there are 100 people attending a particular meeting, probably only one or two sits there with the Bible and diary, and all the others sit there without the Bible, without diary, and horror of horrors, some of them even forget biblical protocol and they sit there without even proper clothing. There have been some occasions when, as an admin, I had to switch off the video of people so that their image, half-naked image, is not seen by others. So when Uncle John Abraham said, are you opening your, do you open your Bible, do you write your notes, this came suddenly to my mind. And 4 months ago, I stopped screen sharing. I'm not finding fault with any brother who shared screen here. They have their reasons for screen sharing. And I have my reason for not doing screen share during Zoom. And let me tell you the reason why I don't want to share. And the reason is, I'm going to give you an exposition of certain Bible verses related to our topics. And as Uncle John Abraham said, I want you to open your Bibles. If your Bible is somewhere besides you, you can take a moment, just retrieve it, keep it in your lap, and as I read the Bible, you also open and read the Bible, and you start taking notes. Reading the Bible for yourself and taking notes is a very important activity, because it has been found psychologically that when we read the Bible for ourselves and when we take notes, the illumination which has come to you, the spiritual illumination which has come to you, it imprints on your mind. That is exactly what we want. That is what I want. That this message from the Holy Spirit, which He gave me, and which He, Holy Spirit, is enabling you to understand, it should imprint upon your mind. What is the use if it doesn't imprint on your mind? So, if the Bible is beside you, open it. If you can, if it is at a distance, pull it out, bring it, diary, pen, and whatever illumination which the Holy Spirit gives you, as I expound the scripture, please note it down. And for this evening of Bible exposition, I would want you, I request you to open to Psalm first chapter, or the first Psalm. The first Psalm, we will read the first three verses, but only step by step, not the whole of it. If anyone has their mics on, I request them to turn it off. There is some background sound. I turn one off. If there is anyone, please turn it off. The first Psalm starts by saying, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. What is the significance of that? Psychological researchers have shown that whether you are able to enjoy something or not depends upon whether you have formed a habit to enjoy. And I want to focus upon that. Now, I'm sure that many of you love cheese. When someone gave me a piece of cheese for the first time, that was 40 years ago, I took one bite and spit it out, because real good cheese, not that Amul one, that is a sanitized cheese. It is not the real cheese has an awful smell and taste also. It might be an awful taste when you eat it for the first time. But today, I love all kind of cheese. Why? Is it because the taste of cheese has changed? No. Rather, it is because I realize that cheese is a healthy food and therefore I should consume it. So I started consuming it. Little by little by little, I started consuming it, and eventually I fell in love with cheese. So whether you love something or not does not automatically depend upon whether it is good or bad. Please remember that. It depends upon whether you have formed a habit for that. Let me illustrate with another example. I was a college student and also a university student. And many, many of my companions used to smoke. I also was a professor in the university, and many of my companions used to smoke. After smoking, they would go and wash their mouth and try to remove all smell. I would always ask, man, if you feel that the smell is awful, if you feel that you have to hide it, then why in the first place did you pick it up? And they always, without exception, said, Johnson, I did not want to pick it up. But when I was in college, when I was in university, it was considered fashionable. And since it was considered fashionable, I tried it. I experimented with smoking, and eventually I ended up a smoker. See, they did not like it. It was offensive to their mouth. It was offensive to their nose. But just because of social pressure, they tried it. The correct word is peer pressure. Your peers, those who are your companions, they exert a great pressure upon you to try it. So because of peer pressure, they tried it. It was not good. It was offensive. But gradually, they started liking it. They became victims. They became habituated to it. Psychology has shown very clearly that whether you like something or not often depends upon whether you practice using that thing. just as I practiced and fell in love with cheese. But my friends, they practiced smoking because of peer pressure and fell in love with smoking and became victims. In the same way, whether we love the scripture depends upon whether we practice reading the scripture. Whether we enjoy our Christian life depends upon whether we really try to practice to enjoy our Christian life. If the first thing you and I do in the morning after getting up is to simply rush to WhatsApp, then you're practicing a love for something that, instead of contributing to your spiritual life, is probably draining your spiritual life. I said probably because there are some people who use WhatsApp for good purposes to circulate wholesome material. But even within the Christian community, whatever is circulated, less than 1% is wholesome. And there are very few people who can distinguish between that which is wholesome and that which is a curse to you, which is wasting, which is a time killer. So if that is your first love, obviously the Christian faith is not your first love. If the Christian faith is your first love, then the scripture would be the first thing to which you would rush in the morning, because the scripture repeatedly reminds us, particularly in places like 119th Psalm, that morning is the time when we should focus upon the scripture. So let's go back to what I was saying. Whether you like something or not depends upon whether you develop the taste for it. And whether you develop the taste for it depends upon not the taste of the thing, but upon your decision to develop a taste and your initiative to develop a taste. Psychology has also shown that if you do something regularly and routinely for 5 to 8 weeks, it becomes your habit. Nothing becomes a habit in a day or two. A certain minimum period is needed. So, average minimum period would be 5 weeks. But for some people, it may need 8 to 9 weeks of continuously forcing you to do it. So, if you want to fall in love with your Christian faith, you need to fall in love with the guide for Christian faith, and that is the scripture. And if you want to fall in love with the scripture, then the second verse, his Psalm, first chapter, or the first Psalm, second verse, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. You may say, Johnson uncle, that is an impossible thing. I'm a student. I have to give a certain number of hours to studies, or I am an employed person. And I also saw some homemakers. I am a homemaker. I have to give certain amount of time to homemaking. And how is it possible to delight? How is it possible to meditate day and night? You need to understand that to meditate day and night, it is not necessary to read the Bible day and night. Meditate is a mental activity. And therefore, in the morning, when your mind is completely free of distraction, when it is fresh, and when it is in a condition to absorb the scripture, when it is in a condition to accept illumination from the Holy Spirit, at that time, if you give number one priority to the scripture, then whatever you read will remain in your mind. And if you practice reviewing what I read this morning, gradually that practice helps you to remember what you read in the morning and the light that the Holy Spirit gave to you in the morning. I know of a number of Christians who, when they get up in the morning, decide that today I will control the following things. Number one, today I will control my tongue. Number two, today I will control my mind. Number three, today I will think divine viewpoint. Today I will not speak against anyone, particularly malicious speech. Five, today I will not give my time to things that are basically worthless. Now, exactly what five things you decide depend upon you. I have been practicing that now for more than 3 decades. I have my own priorities, and based upon those priorities, I have 5 things. Why only 5? Why not 10? Because it's found that remembering 5 things is easier than remembering 10. And 5 is a reasonable number where you can really collect things and decide what you are going to do. Okay. So if you want to enjoy your Christian life, you have to fall in love with the Christian life. And if you have to fall in love with the Christian life, you have to fall in love with the scripture. And if you have to do that, the scripture should be your priority. Get up in the morning, wash yourself, follow proper protocol to go into God's presence. And then read the scripture for that day. Whatever light illumination comes to your heart from the Holy Spirit, note it down. Otherwise, you will forget it. And then throughout the day, try to remember exactly what you read in the morning. Initially, you might have to go through your diary maybe 2, 3, or even 5 times. Doesn't matter. You are developing a habit that is going to sustain you all your life. Eventually, about 5 to 8 weeks from the start of this practice, you will suddenly realize that what I read in the morning is with me throughout the day. That is what is mentioned here in Psalm, the first Psalm, verse 2. His delight is in the law of the Lord. That means the first thing he in his life, the first thing or the number one priority is in the law of the Lord. That is the Bible. And because of that, his law does he meditate day and night, morning to evening, up to night. Those words, that illumination will keep coming to you. You may ask Johnson, uncle, do you practice what you preach? Yes, I've been practicing. That is why I tell you that what you read in the morning will definitely come to you for your reflection and meditation day and night, my dear young ones, and also the not so young ones who are listening to me. It is never too late in the Christian life. There is nothing like too late. Please remember, there is nothing like too late. If you have been in the habit of grabbing the smartphone the first thing in the morning, please remember 99% of things which this smartphone brings to you is trash. Why give first priority to it? And Dr. John Abraham mentioned a lot of other things. I'm not going to review them, but please give due importance to those things, because gradually all that unholy stuff, that trash, is filling minds. And if it is garbage inside, it will be garbage outside. And many of you who have learned computer programming in schools and at other levels, you know that is a standard statement about computer programming. Garbage in, garbage out. In the same way, you are programming your brain. By putting garbage in, naturally garbage will come out. If you put trash, trash will come out. Please understand these things. So, if you want to enjoy your Christian life, you have to delight in the law of the Lord. And then in his law should you meditate day and night. All the young men and women and the not so young ones, please memorize Psalm 1:1-3. But there are 2 more very important verses that I want to quote to you, because this is basically a Bible exposition. The other is, now note this and do memorize this, Proverbs 4:23. Proverbs 4:23 says, Proverbs 4:23, watch your heart with all diligence, because from it flow the springs of life. So ultimately, the spring of life is inside our heart. Today, almost all of us have water pumped through pipes to our homes. But if there is anyone here who has a well in his house or her house, they understand that the well is replenished by the springs inside it. It's a source of fresh water. So when the scripture says that from it flows the spring of life, what the scripture is saying is that the origin of your spiritual life is in your heart, and therefore you have to watch your heart with all diligence. Why did I pick up this verse? Once again, to ask you exactly what is the stuff with which you fill your hearts. The other day, a brother asked me, Bade bhaiya, I sent you a couple of redirects into your WhatsApp. Did you read them? And let me tell you, I don't read something. I don't waste my time unless somebody tells what it is. Because once they tell what it is, I can decide whether it is useful for me or not. Oh, he said just a little bit of worldly trash. Why should a Christian believer, a Christian leader, the elder of an assembly, why should he forward worldly trash to another Christian leader and a Christian teacher and a church leader? Is it not a waste of the time? Why is he wasting his time? Why is he wasting my time? Because he is not guarding your heart. And since it is not guarding his, he is not guarding his heart, instead of spring of life, it has become a spring of trash. It is spewing out trash, and he wants to share that trash with others. There is another verse that I want to quote to you to close my class today, and that is Psalm 119:9. My dear brothers and sisters, my dear teens, all these three quotations that I gave you, you must memorize them. This one, Psalm 119:9, says, how can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to your word. Not if your primary attention is towards trash. So let me summarize all what I said. Are you able to enjoy your Christian life? You would not be able to enjoy your Christian life if you have not kept your way pure. And you cannot, that is Psalm 119:9. We are going in the reverse. Number two, if you do not watch your heart with all diligence, that means if you have not kept your heart pure, then you will not watch your heart with all diligence. And you are losing the spring of life. It is becoming spring of trash. And then Psalm 1 verse 2, which says, his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. Are you doing that? Thank you.